little different than the previous follow-up presentations. There are five questions set for this session. My presentation, just to help you to follow up, is linked to the third question, approximately that is. And that question is the question of what are the main factors of transition to the green growth. Now the path for answers was opened yesterday gently by the opening speech. In his opening speech, Mr. President, His Excellency Nazarbayev, I noted down, said the world needs a scenario to have a safe and green environment. Now, I have that scenario for you. He also spoke of eco-friendly development. Also, Mrs. Noreen Hazer, in her opening speech yesterday, highlighted the growing disparities and increasing conflicts, and picking up the keywords. I tried to locate my speech in a way, which is important. I quote, she said, we live in an interdependent world. Also yesterday, in our package, we had this Eurasian Economic Review. While waiting His Excellency Mr. President, I went through the one-third of the journal, read it line by line, and I found only one text that is related to my presentation, which relieved me in a way, and that was by Rajendra Pachwari, sorry for the pronunciation, Nobel Peace Prize winner 2007. Everyone speaks about carbon reduction, gas emissions, asbestos, but he points out two lifestyles, the key word that also wraps up my presentation, if I have any time left from the quotations. I'm not a hard scientist. I will speak of anthropogenic impact reduction. And also Yuri Yakovets, again in the same review, speaks of intercivilizational partnership, and refers to the deep gap between the rich and the poor. And this is the context I had to share with you my presentation will be placed in. In the last decade, prime minister, presidents, and in many countries have been promising and promising their electorate green and sustainable growth. That is good news. However, in order to confront the epidemic of global warming and shape a safe economic future, we need to combine two G's, green and growth. Growth has two dimensions, physical and spiritual. If we were to convincingly make the case for green growth, country by country, we will not succeed in putting the world on a sustainable growth path, nor will we be able to prevent the impacts of climate change. Growth is all related about anthropogenic impact reduction and ethics. The conference definition on green growth session refers to the idea of a green economy and anthropogenic impact reduction, and I believe that green growth is only possible by reducing the negative anthropogenic impact on environment. The key words in my presentation are ecocide, like genocide, ecoethics, sociopolis, and gently they change the word to deeper cognition in the list of the titles, and sustainable development. However, since I'm a professor of world religions and ethics, not hard scientist, my approach will be more with the philosophical, ethical, and policy dimension of the topic. It will even go further and claim that scientific approach ignores the holistic dimension of life, and therefore is not able to offer sustainable solutions for our environmental concerns. The most instrumental and or strategic concept for our environmental concerns is the concept of sustainability, very popular word. Now, with the World Summit on Sustainable Development, Rio 20, as Ben said before, next month, the main objective of the summit will be to secure renewed political commitment to sustainable development by addressing new and emerging challenges such as green economy in eradicating poverty. Now, the poverty is at the heart of this discussion. Now, if this was our core objective, then we could safely say that no political commitment or policy may be successful without a philosophically and ethically coherent worldview and vision. This vision are called eco-ethics. Not ecology, but eco-ethics. We need an eco-ethics to reduce the anthropogenic impact and to eradicate poverty in the context of green economy and green growth. UN Resolution March 2010 refers to, I quote, the continuing need to ensure a balance between economic development, social development, and environmental protection as interdependent, mutually reinforcing pillars of sustainable development. The UN resolution also reaffirms that eradicating poverty, changing unsustainable patterns of production and consumption. The UN resolution on sustainable development invites relevant stakeholders, including organizations and bodies of the UN, major groups involved in the area of sustainable development to provide ideas and proposals reflecting their experiences and lessons learned as a contribution to sustainable development and green growth. I take this UN invitation personal and would like to point out that to use the phrase in the UN resolution, I quote, interdependency of economic, social and environmental pillars of sustainable development as well as the idea of changing unsustainable patterns of production and consumption requires a holistic approach to life and environment. A holistic approach to life and environment. Green growth, therefore, is essentially an inescapably moral and ethical issue, not only a technological issue, since decisions being made about climate change are value judgments determined through social political processes, taking into account considerations such as development equality and sustainability, as well as uncertainties and risks. Decision-making processes should take into account the ethical dimension of the policies. We cannot get very far in discussing why climate change is a problem without invoking ethical considerations. If we do not think that our own actions are open to moral assessment, or that various interests, our own, those of our kin, country, those of distant people, future people, animals, nature, if we do not think that those matter, then it is hard to see why climate change, or much else, poses a problem. But once we have seen this, then we appear to need some kind of moral responsibility, morally important interests, and what to do about both. And this puts us squarely in the domain of ethics. However, we live in technopolis, technocities. Our technocity life prevents us from realizing that climate change, everything else mentioned in Kyoto protocols, is essentially an ethical issue, a position towards life in totality, lifestyle, as mentioned by the Nobel Prize winner. The basic premise of technopolis is that man is here on this earth to dominate and exploit nature to the fullest. As a teacher of world religions and ecology, it hurts me to see that the great superpowers and industrialized nations are responsible for more than 85% of the total pollution and toxic waste discharged on this planet Earth. A simple deduction is, if a country wants to be a developed nation, be a major pollutant, pollute everywhere, or else it will remain a backward, underdeveloped, and poor nation. Imagine 15 major industrialized countries account for nearly 85% of the total world population pollution. If this trend is